CitizenNewscaster.com.
Today, CitizenNewscaster.com is reporting from in front of the Colton Hall, located in Monterey, California. It was here, in 1849, that the California State Constitution was drafted and signed in both English and Spanish. This birthplace of the California State Constitution symbolizes this year's statewide elections, because these elections could fundamentally amend the California State Constitution and change the way that you and I perceive and enjoy our civil liberties for generations to come. Hello, my name is Timothy Barrett, reporting for CitizenNewscaster.com. And I can't imagine anything more appropriate for a series on an election which will contain propositions that could potentially and forever amend the California State Constitution than being seated at the very site at which the Constitutional Convention was presided over, debated, and signed in 1849. This is the November ballot pamphlet. It's 147 pages. I've had questions over the details and the ramifications of some of these propositions. To answer our questions, we've read the full text of the four propositions that we'll be covering during this series. Then, wherever we had questions about what we would be reading, we took notes and sought out people within our community who had the knowledge and expertise to answer our questions in plain language. We hope that you'll find this series on Propositions 1A, Proposition 4, and Proposition 8 and 11 helpful as you go to the polls on November 4th to cast your vote.
My name is Robert Cruikshank. I'm the media coordinator for the Monterey County Democratic Party, and I'm a supporter of Proposition 1A. Proposition 1A, as it's now called, is the high-speed rail initiative. And that will provide $9.95 billion of funding to build a high-speed rail line and train service between San Francisco, Gilroy, Fresno, Los Angeles, and Anaheim. There are $950 million of that will go to non-high-speed trains to augment passenger rail service that's already here. I support it, the Monterey County Democrats support it, and the California Democratic Party supports this, mainly because it's an absolutely necessary way for us to have sustainable transportation that can get people around the state quickly and affordably in the face of rising fuel prices and climate change, both of which will limit our ability to maintain the transportation system we currently have. The bill to create a high-speed rail authority was originally done in 2002. It was originally supposed to go to voters in 2004. Arnold wanted that postponed to 2006 because he didn't want these bonds to compete with his budget balancing bonds that year. In 2006, he pushed through an infrastructure bond to build some more roads and freeways, and he didn't want high-speed rail to compete with that either. So he moved it to 2008. So that's why we're voting on it now as opposed to 2004. Arnold has kept pushing it back.
I'm Debbie Hale. I'm the executive director for the Transportation Agency for Monterey County. And the Transportation Agency supports Prop 1, the high-speed rail bond measure, because we know that it's important to provide an alternative means for our residents, our business travelers, and visitors to get to and from Monterey County. And this measure will not only facilitate high-speed rail up and down the state, but will also help fund our connections in Monterey County to this new high-speed rail network. Bonds are used often to build infrastructure because it's something that lasts over a long period of time. So if you pay for it up front, then you get to have it for all those years that you would have been actually saving money for it. But it's important for people to know that this money is coming out of the already constrained state budget, but it's being done that way because it's an investment in our future, and it'll cost us less to build it now through financing than it would to wait however long it would take for us to save up this money, which might never happen.
A general obligation bond is a bond that has to be paid out of the general fund. Some bonds are what we call revenue bonds, where the money is paid back through user fees. The California Legislative Analyst Office, which is a nonpartisan analyst up in Sacramento, has concluded that we can afford these bonds as a state, that it's not going to cause any bigger hole in our state budget. It's not a tax in any way, because it's not going to mandate new revenues. It's just going to come out of the general fund as is, but it's going to be parceled out in small doses over the course of about 20 years. So again, the legislative analyst whose job it is to assess the impact of new spending on the budget has said we have the room in our general fund to make those payments without necessitating a tax increase. The bond, Prop 1A, will provide $10 billion to get the project started. The total cost of the line from San Francisco to Los Angeles to Anaheim is around $30 billion. The federal government will make up about $10 to $15 billion of the rest, and private enterprise will finish it out. Both of them have indicated strong interest in helping pay for this, but they need California to make the first step. Neither Congress nor private enterprise is going to put down any money until we've put down our stake, you might say. So once we invest $10 billion, Congress comes in and invests $10 to $15 billion, private enterprise comes in and invests the rest. None of that happens unless we take the first move.
My name is Christina Watson. I'm a senior transportation planner at the Transportation Agency for Monterey County, and I support Proposition 1 because it will provide an alternative for everyone in California to be able to choose a transportation mode that fits their needs.
The High Speed Rail Authority has been conducting the conceptual design, the route, and taking a look at the environmental impacts of the various routes. And so this bond will come along and move them then into the next phase. They've selected the route, and now they need to actually start designing it and getting ready to build it. And so the new commission will focus on those next steps.
High speed rail does seem pretty good. If ever there was a time when we needed new jobs and affordable transportation, it's now. But who is it that will have control over how the rail bond money is invested?
The California Transportation Commission is appointed by the governor. It's actually appointed by whoever is the governor, and then they have terms that sometimes span longer than who's the governor. It also has two representatives from the legislature, the two different transportation committee chairs. And interestingly enough, the CTC, as they're called, has been relatively apolitical. It's geographically spread out, so there's people from Northern California, people from Southern California. And the bond measure talks about how they will allocate this $950 million portion that is used for connections to high-speed rail. We're very interested in that in Monterey County because we are going to want to have improved connections. We're going to want a piece of that $950 million.
The High-Speed Rail Authority exists to plan the system, but they can't spend money on their own. A bond measure of this size has to go before voters, so they have to ask voters for the money to start construction.
We have very good relationships right now with the California Transportation Commissioners, and our impression has been that while there's a little bit of a north-south bias, maybe some of the commissions are north, some of them are south. We've rarely had a commissioner from Monterey County, and yet several of them are very interested in our transportation issues. And so, sure, there's potential for some politicization, but actually the CTC is a much more objective body and probably a good place to put those. That responsibility.
The High Speed Rail Bond Authority is actively looking at private-public partnership financing, looking at who from the private business community could come in, step in and help out build this project. And there are other examples of private enterprise helping out with public infrastructure projects around the world.
I would say that the reason why we would want to start this now is that the High Speed Rail Commission has reached a point at where they can't go much further. So in order to keep the project moving forward, for those that feel that high speed rail fills an important niche in our transportation system, that it's important to continue instead of keep waiting. Projects get more expensive as you wait. As you invest in our transportation system, you're investing in our economy, And so this is just one way to keep the project moving forward. Air travel is becoming increasingly problematic in certain of the short-haul markets, which is a perfect place for high-speed rail to come in and fill the gap. There are certain cities that it's very difficult to get around using air travel. And so high-speed rail is a great way to fill that gap and, again, you know, move people, move goods. And so it is a good incentive for us to do that in terms of our economy.
There's a meeting back in Los Angeles in June where a series of private investors met with the high-speed rail authority and talked about their interest in helping fund this project. High-speed rail is a common system of transportation around the world. It's usually profitable in every country that it exists in. And so a lot of private companies see a way to make money. The economy is not doing particularly well right now, so a lot of capital is looking for a sound investment, and they have identified high-speed rail as that sound investment. Certainly, high-speed rail is a very sound investment in France. The high-speed rail system generates an operating profit, which then gets used to subsidize other slower rail service in France. Spain's high-speed rail is so profitable that they can plow the profits from the existing lines into new routes to connect, for example, Madrid to Barcelona. Japan's system is profitable. Taiwan's system has only been open for 18 months and achieved profitability earlier this year. High-speed rail in this project here in California is estimated to create around 160,000 construction jobs immediately. There's a study done earlier this year that suggested it could create as much as 450,000 long-term jobs spurred by the construction of the high-speed rail line. So it's something that for a $10 billion investment now will reap even larger rewards for Californians for the decades to come. Well, the proposition has some specifics on how it will operate, not finely detailed, but for example, it says it'll be minimum achievable headways of 5 minutes. What that means is that they want it to build a system that can have trains coming every 5 minutes. That's their goal. That's a common practice in Japan, for example, and in France. Their headways are usually around 5 minutes. It's up to the authority and up to whoever winds up actually operating the system to determine how that works out in practice, and certainly all safety rules will be honored once that's done, but this is a fairly standard practice for high-speed rail projects around the world.
The point of the high-speed rail system is to move quickly from one end to the other, and the more stations you have in between Los Angeles and San Francisco, the slower the train is going to go because it takes time to get up to the 200 mile an hour speed. So that's why they minimize the stations along the line, but then have feeder routes into those stations that are on the line.
The train is designed to be a fast way to get around our state. If you have too many stations along the line, then the train stops more often and it slows you down. So the goal here is to have a strict minimum on how many substations there will be so the train will move more quickly, so that it's not stopping every 5 miles, for example.
The goal of the High-Speed Rail Authority is to build the system that minimizes sprawl and impacts to the environment. And what that means is that what they're concentrating their stations in already populated areas, downtown cities, and the reason for that is because people already live there and they can get on the train at the station in their downtown area or near to their downtown area without having to drive to get to the station. And one of the main concerns of environmental activists regarding transportation projects is sprawl, which is when the houses are built further and further away from the existing infrastructure. And if the station is put out in the middle of open field where there's nothing there yet, people will start building homes there, and that's seen as sprawl. So the goal of the high-speed rail project and authority is to avoid sprawl inducement and just build the stations where the people already are, so that if they use the train for commuting purposes in some cases, they will already have easy access to the station from their home and at the other end by their work. It's certainly linked to the carbon footprint issue, because if people can get to the train station by foot, by bicycle, perhaps by bus, then they can leave their car at home and have less of a imprint on the carbon carbon footprint, I guess, emit less carbon dioxide. And taking the train in general is better for the environment than if they were to drive or fly the same distance.
The proposition 1A does encourage what we might call eco-friendly development, because as we understand now, you don't want to have California become a state where its urban landscape is dominated by sprawl. A lot of these new housing developments on the edges of cities are the first and hardest hit by the mortgage crisis, whereas if you look around our state and around the country, areas and city centers are holding their value fairly well. Now, what we need to do is connect these city centers with a high-speed rail line that allows people to travel from San Francisco to Fresno, San Francisco to Los Angeles, Burbank to San Jose, for example, without having to get in a car, without having to get in a plane. So they're living sustainably in a city center, and they're traveling sustainably on an electric train between the other parts of our state.
The other aspect of that looking forward angle is the environment and climate change. And if we can encourage people to take high-speed rail if it's available to them, as opposed to flying, which has a much higher climate impact, that would be better for us in terms of trying to reduce our footprint on the Earth.
The provision that talks about mitigating the impacts to wildlife in the measure are in there due to some sensitive areas that the chosen route is going through. And mitigation can involve things such as avoidance. And there's been a lot of talk about how there's a wildlife area that the chosen corridor is going through, the Pacheco Pass route is going through, that there can be some avoidance of those sensitive areas, but there needs, you know, they wanted to make sure that they had spelled out the fact that these issues would be addressed.
The high-speed rail project, to be an environmental success, needs to mitigate its impact on the environment, on wildlife, and on, for example, our skies and air. European high-speed rail systems are well-practiced at doing this. For example, you build underpasses or overpasses that are not covered in concrete but sort of covered in soil and trees that allow wildlife to migrate across the tracks, especially in key migratory corridors. The parts of wilderness in the state that the high-speed rail line will run through, such as the Pacheco Pass, which connects Gilroy to the Central Valley, and the Tehachapi Mountains, which connect the Bakersfield area to Southern California, the train's going to run as a tunnel through that area. So the wildlife that lives in those regions isn't going to be affected by this, because the train will be, you know, several hundred feet below them. The other important factor about the high-speed rail project is that it is powered by electricity. So as a train operates, it's not spewing pollutants into the air. And in terms of where that electricity is going to come from, the high-speed rail authority, just last month received a study showing that they can in fact achieve 100% renewable energy to power this system. The creation of a high-speed rail train will provide a guaranteed buyer for solar, wind, even tidal energy generation, which is something that those industries need. They don't currently have reliable purchasers. The high-speed rail project would provide that reliable purchaser for them. High-speed rail is going to take about 10 years to construct. It's not going to happen overnight. Nor is construction of solar and wind projects. So if the people who want to build solar energy projects or wind energy projects are looking at 2015, 2016, 2017 as a completion date for high-speed rail, then they can plan effectively, and that gives them the lead time they need to build the capacity that we would need. Now, the same study that I talked about, the renewable electricity study that the authority commissioned, said that high-speed rail will save about 12 billion tons of carbon emissions in the state every year. The electricity requires would produce 5 billion tons. So that's still a net savings of 7 billion tons of electricity and carbon emissions unless we actually power it renewably. If the high-speed rail system is powered 100% renewably, which it can be, then there is no cost to the environment.
One of the things that I wanted to mention about the bond measure is this $980 million that's available for connections. That's very important to us in Monterey County because we view that as a potential revenue source for the kind of passenger rail programs that Christina was talking about, extending commuter rail down to Salinas, adding a new commuter rail into Monterey, and then making those link up with the Gilroy connection. And so that's an important feature that we see directly benefiting us in Monterey County that will not only get us to high-speed rail, but it'll also just facilitate rail service within Monterey County.
Most people seem to like the idea of fast, affordable, cross-state transportation. But don't most government-backed programs create new bureaucracies? That's all we need is another bureaucracy.
Well, Prop 1A, the high-speed rail bond, will not create any new bureaucracy. Right now, the High-Speed Rail Authority already exists, and they'll handle $9 billion of that $9.95 billion in the bond. The other $950 million that's not going to high-speed trains is going to other forms of passenger rail that already exist in our state to connect to the high-speed system. That $950 million will be administered by the California Transportation Commission, which is, again, another existing body that helps allocate transportation funds. They're appointees of the governor and confirmed by the state senate. But there's more specific guidelines on how they actually allocate that money. It's not a free-for-all. For example, some of the existing Amtrak California lines, the slower passenger rail systems like the Pacific Surfliner that connects LA to San Diego, or the Capital Corridor that connects San Jose to Sacramento, are specifically given about $50 million each. So the California Transportation Commission has strict guidelines on what they have to do with that money. Part of the guidelines are financial, saying that you can only receive so much money. For example, the Amtrak California routes are limited to $50 million each. Metrolink, which is operated by the Southern California Railroad Authority, has specific guidelines on how they can get that money. They have to have a series of agreements with member agencies in place before they will be given any money. So that's another example of the guidelines and safeguards that are in place to ensure that this money is spent effectively and that there's some solid planning that goes into how that money is going to be allocated.
Lots of people have the opportunity to travel abroad, and they're fortunate enough to benefit from those inter-country rail systems that exist in, let's say, Europe. And yet in the United States, certainly in California, we really are behind the times. And right now, with gasoline being so expensive and the issue of greenhouse gases and trying to lower those emissions, it's really important to invest in a future that allows us to get around without having to drive everywhere. And right now, it really is limited in terms of rail travel unless you happen to be in the right location. And in Monterey County, we're working very hard to try to improve passenger rail service, but for long-haul service, it would be very beneficial to have a high-speed system that we could connect into, and certainly Gilroy is very close. It's within an hour of Salinas, maybe a little farther from Monterey, and so that's accessible via public transit, or even if you drive to the station, instead of driving all the way down to Los Angeles, or driving all the way up to Sacramento, which we do a lot. It would be great to be able to get on a train and have a very fast ride and not have to pay for all that gasoline and not have to be polluting the environment as much. And I hope that can be part of our transportation future in California.
I think it's important to keep in mind that the cost of doing nothing is much higher than the cost of high-speed rail. California is going to spend $10 billion on this bond, $30 billion to build this first part of the system, and once we connect Sacramento and San Diego, the total cost will be around $40 billion. That's a lot of money, but it's cheaper than the alternative, which includes doing nothing. If we do nothing, the cost of, for example, flying between north and south is going to skyrocket. Already, airlines like United Airlines are cutting back their flights between San Francisco and LA because of the fuel crunch. The cost of the climate is going to be enormous, and that has economic impacts. High-speed rail serves a transportation user base that if we didn't have high-speed rail, would require between $80 billion and $150 billion in new freeway lanes and new airports, runways, gates, all of that. So when you look at the entire picture of transportation in California and where we're going to go from here into the future, high-speed rail is actually the cheapest option. Even doing nothing is going to cost us more money than it will take to build high-speed rail.
As we've seen, high-speed rail is the right thing to do in terms of the environment, producing less carbon-based pollution and relieving strain on our overcrowded highways. But Proposition 1A is also about jobs. Jobs which cannot be moved out of California, providing income for California industries and workers, which may be just what California needs to keep its economy on track. Citizen Newscaster believes that Proposition 1A is good for the California worker, good for industry, and good for California. Thank you for joining us for this issue of CitizenNewscaster.com, and we hope that you'll join us again when we cover issues relevant to your community, Central California, and beyond. The broadcast is a production of CitizenNewscaster.com. Cast your vote. CitizenNewscaster.com.